If you'll play this major, I'll sing it.
So everybody, I play that after this, the next thing we play is.
That's awesome.
After the prelude, the next thing we play is All Are Welcome.
I think we're going to hang out here until the first message.
All Are Welcome. It's right after the passing of the piece, so we'll give it like 30 seconds. I'll come over here and like give you a few. Otherwise, just give it 30 seconds. All
Are Welcome. This house is cute.
Welcome to worship at Countryside Community Church on this Eastertide Sunday. Everyone looks a little bit sleepy. No, you actually look lovely and wonderful and beautiful. We have enjoyed such a wonderful journey through Lent and Holy Week and celebrated last week on Easter Sunday. Christ is risen. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's go try that one more time. Christ is risen. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. As we're making our way into the sanctuary, know that no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are indeed welcome at Countryside. You're welcome here if you are joining us in the sanctuary in person. You're welcome if you are joining us online from somewhere else. Just know that the Spirit welcomes each and every one of us. Thank you for adding your spirit and story and presence to this body of Christ fellowship. There are so many things happening in the life of our church each and every week. If you are new and visiting and are interested in getting involved, please see me or Sarah or one of our staff after church, somebody who knows what's going on. That might be somebody else besides me, but if they look like they know, Joyce knows all the answers. Just find her and she'll let you know. But there's always something for everyone, so know that you have a home here. As you're getting settled, I do invite you to slow down your breathing. Find yourself rooted in the place that you are. And know that Spirit grounds each and every one of us together by a common bond of love and fellowship. So let us now take a deep breath in. Inhale slowly. Breathe in the breath of God. And exhale, releasing all that keeps you from experiencing God's peace. Let us continue our worship with prayer and praise.
Please join me in the call to worship. We have gathered from our different places to worship here. How good it is to worship together in unity. We come from our different occupations, our diverse activities. How good it is to worship together in unity. We come as unique individuals, bound together in the love of Christ. How good it is to worship together in unity. And now let us share signs of peace with one another. The peace of God be with you.
Good morning. Any of my young friends that are like 4 or up to 6th grade that want to come to Children's Church, we're going to gather and head over there within a safe distance from the fire. Yeah. No, yeah, no. All righty. Wait.
If it gets unstuck.
Okay.
We're going to say our prayer and then we'll have
We light our candle and carry the light of our community with us. You are with us in the chapel and we are with you in the sanctuary. Amen.
From 1 John, we declare to you what was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked at and touched with our hands, concerning the word of life. This life was revealed, and we have seen it and testify to it, and declare to you the eternal life that was with the Father and was revealed to us. We declare to you what we have seen and heard so that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him while we are walking in darkness, we lie and do not do what is true. But if we walk in the light, as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. My little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world.
Our gospel lesson this morning is from John chapter 20, verses 19 through 31. Let us listen for God's words in these words of Holy Scripture. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet come to believe. Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. Words of hope for a hopeful people. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Holy God, as we gather here, rising to new life on this Eastertide Sunday, we come seeking presence, we come seeking hope and joy, but we come with doubts, asking, longing for you to continue to reveal yourself, that peace might be upon us, that we might be your hands and feet, bringing the gift of spirit to your people. God, we know that no human words or actions can ever fully testify to the magnitude of your grace, to the depths of your love for each one of us. But may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts gathered here be pleasing in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Over the next few weeks, the Christian church will be celebrating the season of Easter. Anyone know how to celebrate? Amen? Anyone know how to celebrate? Woo, right? Over the next few weeks, we will be celebrating the season of Easter, which will lead us to Pentecost with a rest stop at the ascension of our Lord. Traditionally, the Easter season is considered such a special time for the church when those gathered on Sundays for worship renew their baptismal vows and are sprinkled again with holy water that has been blessed at the Saturday Easter Vigil. Those are the really, really good Christians. The 50 days represent a single celebration and the central aspect of our lives as Christians, God's resurrection of the Christ. The season of Easter comes to a close and ordinary time returns on the Monday after Pentecost Sunday, on which the church celebrates the descent of the Holy Spirit and the birth of the church from Acts chapter 2. That's a lot, right? I have only been the pastor here at Countryside for 4 months. We've already birthed the baby, put him in the tomb, and brought him back to life. My work here is done. Thank you very much. But the truth is that all of this work and our emotional commitment to journeying with Jesus, understanding our faith and our own stories, depends on the season of Easter, when we renew our faith and we celebrate all that life in Christ has to offer. It is no coincidence that Eastertide, the 50 days set aside to celebrate hope and joy, following the 40 days of the season of Lent and lament, the opposite of celebration, is rather underplayed in the modern church. Most of us honestly don't even know there is a season of Easter or that it is the longest liturgical season in the Christian year. Raise your hand if you knew that. See, my work here is done. But you better believe that we know when Advent begins, how long it is, what it looks like and smells like, the order of things that take us from point A to point B. Even the youngest among us knows what it means when we drag a 10-foot Douglas fir into our living rooms and decorate it with tiny figurines and flashing lights. Yes? Is it any wonder that we are more inclined to wander a Lenten desert, thirsting and in want for 40 days, looking inward, contemplating the spiritual life, the woundedness of the soul, and some of us, the really good Christians, sacrifice the vices that keep us distant from what truly sustains us? Chocolate, wine, Facebook, red meat, all that other stuff. Is it any wonder we're more prone to do that than to fling ourselves freely into the 50 days full of joy and hope and the vulnerable life? How is it that we can lean so deeply into the lamenting soul, but run scared, or at least a little apathetic, towards the season set apart for celebration? Somebody has some thoughts about that. Dr. Brené Brown, you might love her, you might used to have loved her, but she's a great researcher, research professor at the University of Houston Graduate School of Social Work. She says, sheds light on this joy conundrum, saying that joy is the most vulnerable emotion we experience. If you cannot tolerate joy, what you do is start to dress rehearse tragedy. Dress rehearsing tragedy, she explains, is imagining that something bad is going to happen when in reality nothing is wrong. How many of you have ever stood over your child while they're sleeping and thought, oh my God, I love you so much, and then pictured something horrific happening to them? Or woke up one morning and thought, oh my gosh, job's great, family, kids are great, parents are good, this can't last. When is the next shoe going to drop? There's a full spectrum of human emotions, and when we numb the dark, we numb the light. There's no such thing as selective emotional numbing, says Brown. If you want to feel the joy, you have to be able to feel the pain and the grief and the sadness. And no, we don't want to, but it's necessary. Interestingly, it can be just as complicated for many of us to feel joy, right? Sad or stressed may feel comfortable in its familiarity. Hence the affection for marking ourselves with stardust every Ash Wednesday. These rituals match up well with the stories we often tell ourselves about who we are. Maybe less than. We don't deserve celebration. We're fearful. Somebody might find out some secret about me that's different than everybody else's secrets. As a new mother, I used to think myself morbid as I raced to Sage's bedroom every night, expecting him to be lying lifeless in his bed simply because he was alive and perfect and wonderful. Such a beautiful gift in my life, right? He was everything and I couldn't lose everything. And then Quinn came along and suddenly there's double perfect everything to worry about. And now I have two children that I stare at their face every single night. Don't tell them, but it's true. They're 8 and 11. When does that go away? As it turns out, this is a common phenomena called foreboding joy. Foreboding joy, this is Brown's term, joy has an intimate relationship with vulnerability. Our actual experience of joy, those intense feelings of deep spiritual connection and pleasure, sees us in a very vulnerable way. When something good happens, our immediate thought is that we better not let ourselves feel it, because if we really love something, we could lose it. So we shut down our ability to completely enjoy so that we can also shut down our capacity for feeling loss. Perhaps one of the reasons the church is so ambivalent about this Easter season on the heels of Holy Week is that we are jet-lagged with emotions, just like the disciples whom Jesus appeared to behind locked doors in John's text this morning. In fear, he writes, they're hiding out in the room. You know which room? The room where Jesus left them, where they had lifted a glass, reclined, and eaten Passover many times. The same room where he said one of them would betray him. And he did. The question is, will they be able to accept this new peace the risen Christ offers? Will we be able to live this new birthed resurrection life? Over the last 6 weeks, marked by our humanity, we sought solace in the desert with a Jesus we could relate to. Through the eyes of Peter, we walked on water, we sank a little bit with fear, and then we stood up as one in the crowd, watching the drama, denying Christ, holding the grief and fear of the world as bystanders to the drama. Then waving our palms, we celebrated this King of the Jews who conquered fear and held us up as our fasting, flailing spirits looked up at the temptations of the night sky. Then, just as the baby who was born ousted as if a beast of the earth, we stood by and watched as they tied his hands and feet again like the animal he rode on. And betrayal numbed us. Numbed all the hope and joy of Easter that was birthed on that cold December morning. Maybe, just maybe, that's why the church often forgets there is an Easter season of celebration, because we've numbed the pain and the joy. But Christ returns to set us free for peace. For some of us, this numbing has nothing to do with Jesus. I mean, we might blame it on Jesus and say, oh yeah, that's exactly right, Pastor, yeah. But it has everything to do instead with our own beasts, our own ousting, our own losses, our own hidden pain or suffering. Like the disciples, we want to keep the door shut, locked on whatever trauma is knocking. Maybe something we wanted to stay hidden was exposed beyond our control, thus burying it along with the God who just won't quit showing up, reminding us of this pain. Feels better than pretending there's something to celebrate. On this second Sunday of Easter, we are face to face with the risen Jesus, a man who was once lying down in a grave, wrapped as tightly as the secrets and suffering we'd like to keep bound up. And then, as if to remind us that not even our secrets, our wounds that won't heal, can keep us from the complete, all-encompassing love that God fills every broken place, that screams hope and joy. He rose. And one by one, the secrets were revealed, the pain tossed in a pile of soiled and stinky cloth, shaken off alongside the death trap we tried so hard to hide our pain behind. Tossed in a pile with stinky rags. Hallelujah, church. Hallelujah, it is Easter. Christ is risen, the chains are broken, death has lost its sting. And with it, we are invited to release our pain, to rise, to stand up, to join in this peace-building community. Our secrets, our suffering, whatever else we are holding on to, we are called to let go. Face it all. Come out of hiding. Yes, fear is real. Fear is very real. Tragedy and loss could not be more real. If we face our challenges head on, will we lose something? Maybe. Probably. Will we gain something else entirely? You better believe it. Because when the stakes are high, I mean really high, we are not alone. Death was still lingering in the air. The sweat of their brows was visible as they sat huddled together in that room they had shared the Passover meal with Jesus a few days earlier, when betrayal and sorrow stole the day. The stakes were high, but before they lost all hope, before they had convinced themselves that this had all been for nothing, love showed up in its rawest form, its most vulnerable state, with wounds still visible. He said these words, "Peace be with you, my friends. The Holy Spirit is with you, my friends." Some of us are like Thomas. We need to touch and see for ourselves. If that's you, keep showing up. Keep asking your questions. Is this no strings attached love? Is this community that professes to welcome and accept all just as you are, is this the real deal? You've seen new people looking with a side eye when they come in here like, what are these people drinking? Is this the real deal? When we say we are working towards a just and peaceable kingdom here on earth, that means we are working on your behalf, turning the tables when necessary, forgiving 77 times 7 times 7 million times, it's a lot, welcoming the least to this table. If you need to see and touch, keep asking. Keep requesting God's people to show up, because we are Easter people, called to rise, to share in living, creating, and telling the greatest story ever told. But we can't do that if we're busy rehearsing tragedy, holding on to our suffering or our pain. We need to dare to let joy in. Dare to feel it, the pain and the suffering. You'll be surprised to find out that we're capable of experiencing joy amidst suffering. That peace often comes to us when the world seems to be churning out of control. When I was a child, I was pretty sure that if I gave in to the feelings that were just under the surface, that everything would fall apart, that I would likely fall apart too. Anyone else ever feel like that? Never, never. There's a full spectrum of human emotions, and when we numb the dark, remember, we numb the light. It took me years to understand that feeling pain and sitting with it right here was necessary for healing, and that I would not drown in the sadness of my tears, but I actually found that it was through my tears that I could see and experience God's peace more fully. There's no such thing as selective emotional numbing. If you want to feel the joy, we have to feel the pain, the grief, and the sadness. Church, my prayer for you this Easter season is not that you run to your therapist's office right after you leave, but that's an okay choice too. That helps. But that you, right where you are in the middle of your life, messy, beautiful, full of pain and joy, that you can dare to let joy in, that you will awaken to the joy of your own story. Allow the power of the hallelujah to soak into your bones, into your pain, into whatever else you've buried, and let the risen one bring you back to life. Let those around you see you when you're hurting, when you're not at your best, when you need a helping hand. Part of being a child of God and belonging to each other as co-creators means that we are called to use the creative gifts of divine imagination to continue to craft and mold and construct beautiful, messy, real, raw, resurrected lives. St. John Chrysostom reminds us of the importance of this joyful season in his famous Easter homily. He says, "Christ has destroyed death, and now is the feast of faith." Now is the feast of faith. Let us sit around the table together, inviting all, for Christ's love knows no bounds. Friends, may the peace of God be with you. Amen. As we continue our worship, we will now join in a time of prayer. I invite you, as you settle into your own seats, your own spirits, your own stories, to have a moment of silence and dare in those moments to feel all the things, to name, rehearsing tragedy, joy, suffering, pain, and at the end, remember to toss them aside with those soiled linens, because together we rise. Let us pray. Holy God, who knows us inside and out, who hems us in on all sides, who breathes peace upon us and sends your Spirit to be with and within us. On this Easter season day, we claim the promises of your resurrection, that you are seeking to awaken us to joy. God, we also name that we are filled with doubt, that our lives are complicated, that we have suffering and pain and hidden secrets that no one can see, and that we sometimes are also sitting in fear behind locked doors, afraid of what it means to be birthed anew into this Easter resurrected life. And so we profess those fears and those doubts, and we also claim the promise of your resurrected truth, that wherever we sit, alone or in the body, we are never alone. But when we speak your name and seek your face and call out for your grace and mercy, you shower us with gifts of truth and promise and unconditional love. God, as Easter people, we seek to live resurrected lives that embody the witness of your church, that we might be the hands and feet and heart, that we might welcome all to the table, that your justice might reign each and every day, that we might never tire of doing your work. But as we sit rehearsing tragedy, someone else seeks a word of peace and comfort. So bind up those broken hearts on all sides, that we might be raised together as your church, one body, one heart, one mind, called to love and serve one another, your children, and your earth. God, we are so thankful for the beloved teacher, the rabbi, the young Jewish man who said yes alongside the riverbanks, who said yes to partner in faith that all might come to know your love. And so as we gather and commit to listen and to rise, we do so following in the footsteps of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father and Mother in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen."
All right. Well, when Jenny said at the beginning of the service that there is a lot going on, she was not kidding. We have a lot to talk about today. But first, I'd like to remind you to please complete the fellowship register if you haven't already and pass that down your pew. That allows us to know that you are with us today and to be able to contact you if you'd like. We have a number of things happening this month, and this is Creation Justice Month. So you can see this table in our narthex. It is representing our church library, but also lifting up the theme of Creation Justice, Earth Day, Earth Month, and Arbor Day. There are kids' activities and stickers there. You can check out library books straight from the table. There's a sign-out form if you like something that you see right on the table. And we're going to be rolling out a library card system for our library. So you can sign up for your very own Countryside library card at that table. We also, in keeping with the library, next Sunday we'll be rededicating the library, and there will be a reception in honor of that following the service. So I hope that you will plan some extra time next Sunday after worship to join in that. And more books. We are a community of readers, and our anti-racist designation group is inviting you to join a discussion group and choose one of these two books and read them along with one of the groups. So How the Word is Passed will be a group led by Janelle Baber, and Marsha Bloom will be leading a study on The Sum of Us. We are starting a new congregational care ministry called Web of Care, and we'll be hosting an info session about that in Mary's Hall on the 21st. If you are interested in learning more about that or potentially being a caregiver, a coordinator with our Web of Care program, please do plan to attend that session. And if you have any questions before that or in the meantime, please talk to me, and I'd love to talk to you about it. Also that day, immediately after worship in the chapel, you can meet with Pastor Jenny to have coffee with the pastor. This is especially for our new folks and our visitors to get to have some time with her, but all are welcome to that time. And at the end of April, we have Confirmation Sunday. So during this 10 o'clock service, we'll be confirming our group of confirmands who are today on a retreat together, our eighth graders. So I hope that you can plan to join us for that. And week after that, please plan to join us at 2 o'clock in the afternoon for Jenny's installation. So if you'd like, you might want to start constructing a zip line from your house to the church right now so you can just come and go every Sunday for the next month. And now at this time, I'd like to invite Judy Wabel to come forward to talk about what she is planning to help us with to prepare for Pentecost.
Good morning, folks. I'm here to talk to you this morning about Pentecost and as a person gathering a team. You know our reorganization. I'm on the board of Worship and Arts, and I'm gathering a team to decide how we're going to celebrate Pentecost in worship. So I have a few folks who have indicated an interest, and I'm looking for more, and I'm looking for people who are interested in a very beginning liturgical gesture or dance to partake of that in the ceremony. I'm looking for, and those can be, those people can be as young as 6 years older, so there's a role for children, and there's also a role for adults, teens and adults. We will gather those folks to participate in particular activities in worship, and we will rehearse those, whatever they end up being, those acts on three Tuesday nights, April 23rd and 30th and May 14th. And so I'm going to be in the narthex after worship, and you're welcome to come and inquire or sign up for any of that, any of those sensory pathway events that will enhance our worship on Pentecost Sunday. Thanks.
All right, thank you, Judy. And now we come to the time in our service where we talk about sharing our gifts. We are in a new month, and so the recipient for the month of April for the box, which is a way to give tangible gifts as well as our financial gifts, is the LGBTQ Center of Omaha. On the back of your bulletin, the QR code there takes you to the donate page on our website, and if you click on the box, you go to a wish list on Amazon of things that that center would like. And so you can select from that, or you can give a monetary gift so that those items can be purchased by others. But I would invite you to check that out and consider that part of your giving for the month of April. And we also are very grateful for all of the donations that you make to Countryside so that we can continue to enact our mission here on this campus and in this community and to share God's love with this town. Let us take this time now to join our voices in dedicating the gifts that we have given and will give. Let us pray. God of the resurrection, help us use these gifts to offer hope where there is sorrow, peace where there is chaos, and love where there is fear. We can do incredible things because your Spirit lives within us. Amen.
Thank you.
You may be seated. Let us join our voices as we come to the table responsively. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the God of love. It is indeed right to give our thanks and praise to the God who calls us to this table, who reminds us that Jesus first sat at this table with all those who were excluded from other places in society. He welcomed those on the margins, those who were typically labeled as sinners, and he fed them just as he feeds us today. Just as Jenny said, nothing that we do is ever wasted. Nothing we do does not matter. What we do when we celebrate this ritual together means something. It means that we are connected to Christ, who first served his disciples. In that very upper room where we imagine them sitting today, Jesus coming to them and saying, "Peace be with you." We imagine that Jesus sat with them knowing what was to come a few days later, and he still celebrated and held a moment of joy. But he did tell them as he took bread and broke it that this would be his body, which would be broken for them and for us to become the bread of life. When we take this into ourselves, it is like a seed that connects us to the life that Christ gives. He also took the cup and poured it out, lifted it up and gave thanks to God for it, and said that this would represent his blood, which would be spilled, not because of anything that he had done wrong, but in fact because of all that he had done right, all the love that he had given that the powers and principalities said was for the wrong people, but that as his blood would be spilled, it would reconcile us to God above, and it would be for us the cup of blessing, granting us this representative blessing that carries with us, strengthening us to do God's work in the world. And so this morning, we have the opportunity to come together. We do have communion at the table today. We have the opportunity to receive these gifts and to have just a representative moment together in this ritual to connect us to Christ, to connect us to those disciples, to connect us to one another and to all Christians and all who receive this meal around the world. So let us pray to bless these gifts. Holy Spirit, we pray that you would come upon these gifts of bread and the cup, that you would transform them from something ordinary into something extraordinary, just as you transform us from ordinary humans in our hands and feet to members of the body of Christ who do your work in our world. We thank you for all that you have given us, and we pray your blessing upon this meal. Amen. These gifts that we share today are for all of you. We have gluten-free bread and we have non-alcoholic juice. We will have our ushers come forward to help to direct you to the front where you can walk forward and receive this meal. And if you are unable to move from your seat, please wave and we will come to you. Let us share these gifts together as we celebrate this meal. Let us join together now in giving thanks for the meal that we have received. Thank you, God, for renewing us at your table by the presence of our Christ. Thank you for your eternal love, the bread of life that sustains all creation. May you continue to love us in our faithful acts, and by that love, discourage us from our unfaithful acts, that we might rejoice as your servants to the world. Amen. And now let us stand together and sing our closing hymn.
Good morning. The last time I stood before you was an ordinary time in the church calendar, and we talked about you going forth and doing extraordinary things. Well, here we are, it's Easter, and now we need to share the joy of Jesus. Go forth and share the joy of Jesus. As you do that, may the Holy Spirit go before you to show you the way, go above you to protect you and guide you, go beneath you to uphold and uplift you, go beside you as your strong and constant companion, and dwell within you so that you may know you are not alone in this journey of life, and that you are loved, loved beyond your wildest imagination. And may the fire of God's blessing burn brightly within you, upon you, and through you, now and always. And let all the people say,